why it's a great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Elise Huard. When we select a keynote speaker, we look for people who are capable of giving talks on sort of subjects close to our heart, and then we watch videos on the internet that we can find and look for people to give So this year, these videos come out. So these has done functional programming for a couple of years in Haskell. I've given a great number of talks on that. Right now, she works for Mastodon C doing data analysis using Clojure. Today, she will talk about.
Hello everyone. So a few weeks ago, we had a hackathon in an insider hackathon, and so the organizer of the hackathon turned around and said, "Well, why don't we create our own programming language?" And the rest of us, a bit older and a bit more experienced, sort of looked at each other and went, like, "Okay." And basically, the next few hours were a discussion, like, what do we want in this programming language? What do we like about the programming languages we already use? What would it look like? And I guess I'll turn over this question to you. What would your ideal programming language look like? And so that's basically what I propose as a thought experiment. Obviously, programming has moved on quite a bit since people were punching assembly into punch cards. And so when you look at the history of programming, you have this massive tree with lots and lots of branches. And so you have lots and lots of options to choose from. So I'm going to go over a few of these and propose several alleys of thought you could think about when thinking about this problem. So first up, the most obvious one is level. Low level, high level is a clear distinction. Low level means you're going to make a programming language that is designed for a specific hardware. It's custom. So that's what was the case when people were programming in assembly or even in custom COBOL. They were punching programs for this particular computer, but it would work on any other. High level means that your program can get compiled down to several architectures. So most programming languages will be obviously in that category. The low level only happens nowadays for really small low-capacity circuits, devices. The rest of us use high-level language. So I'm guessing you'll go for that. Then you could also have classifications on the purpose. What will your programming language be for? It could be a system language like C or Go or Rust, or which is designed to manipulate system resources. Or it could be a scripting language when you want to quickly roll something like with Bash or any shell or Perl. Ruby was one of these, but it sort of moved on to domain specific, to a general language afterwards. And then we have domain specific languages. So those are, again, kind of custom. And not necessarily Turing complete. They will be very specialized, like robotics or avionics or you know, computing, like algebra of a certain kind, like MATLAB or whatever. Then we have visual languages, where it's really designed like Visual Basic and all that series, where it's originally designed to have some sort of windowing interface going. And then we have esoteric languages, like brain fog comes to mind, like languages that are more for fun, but nobody's saying will ever use. But you know, they could be fun to design, so you could want to go for that, even though you'll never technically really use it. So general purpose languages basically are general purpose, so you could really go for a language you can use for anything. If you don't want to decide right now what your language is going to use for, you just have to make it Turing complete. What does that mean? It has to be able to execute a certain number of functions, new recursive functions, they're called. It's actually a fairly small subset. So if you can make your language do those, then it's Turing complete, and you can theoretically do anything a computer can do with your language. Will it be declarative functional, or will it be imperative? So what's the difference? Well, you all know that probably, but declarative, you say what, in an expression, you say what you want. So in this case, you say, well, I want, from all the numbers between 1 and 20, I want the ones that are smaller than 5. That's what I want. Functional languages often are termed declarative, although they're not technically, they're not when you side effect. Because the moment you side effect, you will say, well, print. So you say, do this. So it's no longer functional at that point, but any point you're not using side effects, you will be declarative. This is Python, by the way. And this is Python as well. And here it's the same thing, but it's imperative. So instead of saying, well, I want all the numbers, from all the numbers between 1 and 20, I want the first 5 or something, you're going to say, well, just going through loop, and I can begin to append them. And I guess you see the difference there. You give the instructions of what it's got to do, not what you want it to do, what you want in the end result. Then we can go dynamically typed versus statically typed. That's also a fairly reasonably clear distinction. Dynamically typed languages. Type is that, I guess in any program you will determine the type of any value you're using at some point. But with dynamically typed languages, you will determine that at runtime. So that means that at compile time, things are not really fixed yet, and when you run your program, you can still have runtime exceptions. An example of this closure, I guess at compile time, your program cannot say yet what types, data, and year will have. Those are the two arguments of the functions. It can just say that, well, we hope it will have a year. The data will have a year. Components will be a map with year, and they can be compared with an equal sign. That's all you can say. Well, statically typed languages, the type of every single value is determined at compile time. And so that means that if your compiler cannot determine what the type of every single variable in the thing is, it will ask you, it will say, well, it's ambiguous, please tell me with a type hint or whatever what you're intending. Is it an int, is it a float, is it a whatever? I cannot determine this from your program structure, which helps in finding, avoiding runtime errors and having everything checked, at least type-wise, at compile time. Then there's something in between those ends, which is called gradual typing. So with Clojure, you can go gradual typing, and there are a few other languages with that as well. So that's they're technically dynamically typed languages, but you can, with type hints or some sort of type specification, say, well, actually, I want this to be an integer, so please enforce this, whatever, at compile time, please. So that's sort of joining between the dynamical and the statical end. I was tempted to talk about strong and weak typing, but it turns out that's a bit of a vague concept. Rather, it's recommended to talk about type safety. So type safety is again whether at the end of the process, whether it's compiling plus running, you know what every single value's type is. And actually most languages comply to this. So for instance, object-oriented languages really do comply to this because every single thing you've got going and every single, I guess, value you have is at the end of the process, it does have it is an instance of a class. So you know for every single variable you have what type it has. Haskell actually is mostly type safe unless you use unsafe perform IO, which allows you to sort of weasel out of the IO monad. So that compromises type safety. And another, I guess, more known example as well is with C, because with C you can explicitly cast a variable to something else. So for instance here, right, you have a char pointer, and then you'll say in the course of your process, well, actually, I want a double pointer. I want this to be a double pointer. So let's transform this into that, which is why C can be notably difficult to debug at times. It's one of the reasons. There are other reasons. Then there's type inference. So once you've got your type system all decided on, will you have type inference? I would recommend yes, but it's harder. Like, if you don't have type inference, like in this bit of C, you have to specify with every single variable, every single value, you have to specify what type you're expecting. With this Haskell, for instance, the compiler will sort of try to do the job for you, so it will do type inference, and that means you have a lot less, boilerplate. I guess you don't have to type like a public static int main, whatever. It's just all inferred for you. Scala has that as well. It's called Hindler-Milner type inference for most common languages. Then we have how will you make it run? Will it be interpreted or will it be compiled? That is actually a spectrum as well. So a lot of choices to make there. So at one end we have interpreted, at the other end we have compiled. Bash is interpreted line by line, so that's like the, it's maybe not the lowest level you can do, I guess you could do this even smaller scale, but line by line interpretation. Then you have for Python, Ruby, Perl, and JavaScript, whole programs or whole files are evaluated at the time. Then if you move on a little bit to the right, you have languages that are so-called just-in-time compilers. So that means that when you run them, there is a certain amount of compilation that goes on that dumps bytecode that is going to rerun. But you still can do eval things, you still can do things that are more properties of Python, Ruby, etc. Because it's slightly in between. It still allows some certain amount of sort of on-the-fly metaprogramming or whatever. Then if you move a little bit further again, you have those languages that are properly compiled, but they're compiled to bytecode, and they run on a VM. So that means you're also going to write a VM to run with those programs on, so that's a possibility as well. And then at the very end of the spectrum, we have the languages that are compiled down to machine code. With that one caveat, I guess. So I put Haskell at the end there, but technically if you use GHCAI, which is the interactive REPL, then you actually go back a bit on the spectrum, you go more towards the bytecode solution, because you need to be able to dynamically run instructions on the fly. So it really depends. So basically, technically, this is not an attribute of the language. This is an attribute of its implementation. So you could have potentially languages there that you could shove back and forth on the spectrum, like for instance Rubies and Ruby, or PyPy and Python illustrate. You can decide to compile something more or less. It's an implementation detail. Then another implementation detail is manual versus automatic garbage collection. So again, C is on one end of that spectrum, because for every single value variable you're going to use, you're going to have to allocate memory, specifically. And at the end of it, at some point, you should really deallocate it or free it. If you don't do that, you will have memory leaks. Most modern languages do garbage collection. That means that in the background, there's something going wrong while you're running the program, going, well, is this variable used at all anymore? Is this data structure used at all anymore? Okay, then we'll just remove it from our feed and move on. I think you could also, there's books about garbage collection. So if you're going to implement a language, there's a whole range of options you could go. You're going to pay a price, obviously. Either it's going to be something ticking along in the background continuously, or it's going to be big, like mark and sweep passes, which will slow down your program at maybe inconvenient times. So there's choices to be made there as well, to depend on what the program will do eventually. But again, it's an implementation detail. So in the past, languages have moved from one type of garbage collection to the next. So that's something you can change in the background as well. Does it have, will it have interesting primitives? I'm thinking about Erlang. So Erlang, for instance, has actors, which allow you to make, and supervisor trees, which allow you to make big distributed concurrent programs that will have very sort of highly available, because anything will be sort of checked and restarted if needed. So that's something you could think about as well, like, how will I make this an interesting language? Do I want this to do something else than other languages have done? You could also think about in terms of capacities. Do you want your language to have you know, primitives or a standard library that allows you to do certain things easier? Like for instance, I'm thinking of R, which has which is a language more for statistical processes. With in R, you have data types which allow you to do matrix calculations very easily, and that's something you're going to need a lot in that kind of processing. So that's also something to think about when you start designing your language. I'm guessing you start to understand why when we decided that shall we make a programming language, that was a bit of like, a lot to think about. So if you want to piggyback on like what people have researched for like tens and tens of years, you might want to use an existing virtual machine. So whether it's you know, the Erlang virtual machines like Elixir does. Elixir, Joseph Alim, who wrote Elixir, decided to write on the Erlang VM. And actually, another contributor to Erlang decided to make a Lisp on the Erlang VM, which is amazing, because then you have all the, you know, primitives and all the infrastructure people who developed Erlang designs, but you write your own language on top of it. But then there's obviously the JVM, everyone knows the JVM. Scala, Clojure, I'm sure there's a lot of new ones, all use JVM, and the JVM has been pounded by the industry for the last 15 years, and lots of PhDs have been on the topics of the JVM. I doubt any of us is capable of designing something as efficient as the JVM in terms of what a virtual machine can do. Then there's LLVM, as well, which is written for a very nice sort of open source alternative. So that's a good thing to do. Then let's talk about syntax. Oh boy. So do you want significant white spots? Or do you want a list? You know, there's many options. I guess I'm going to attack this from a different angle. I don't know if people have heard about syntactic structures. No. So this is more a linguistics concept. So Noam Chomsky discovered that there is such a thing as this universal grammar. So when you teach a child to talk, it's actually going to go surprisingly fast. Because what Noam Chomsky posited and seems to be true is that we already become pre-programmed to a certain extent with syntactic structures, so with a certain basic grammar, and the details get filled in as you learn to speak. So it's not like you're learning from scratch, you already have a preset there. So you can imagine that all natural languages fall under this universal grammar somehow. Contrary of what we could think, natural languages don't span the whole range of possibilities. They're actually quite a limited subset of what would be possible. So if we were to meet aliens, for instance, there's no guarantee that we would have any sort of intersect between their grammar and ours, and that we would even be able to learn their language at all. That doesn't sound. But then we have computer languages. Computer languages fall under a slightly different set of restrictions, as we discussed. So we want them to be usually Turing complete, and we want it to be possible for them to be compiled onto machine code. That's basically it. That's what limits computer language. That's what why you can make very esoteric computer languages. So in the history of computing, I guess we have had a sort of movement in trying to shoehorn those two groups into having a syntax that sort of matches, like having computer languages that have something matching natural language syntax. And with mixed success, we're not quite there yet. But then something else came along, like for the last 5-10 years, more like 5 years, I guess, we've had a movement towards more something resembling mathematical notation. So mathematical notation, again, is something completely different. It's a way of expressing things that potentially is universal. If we met those aliens, maybe we would understand each other on functional algebra, that's possible. So there have been a movement of making syntax and languages that, or using rather languages that already existed, that have something closer to a more mathematical sort of sense to them. So I guess we're now at a point where we're aiming towards something that intersects one or two of these groups, well, obviously preferably around the computer languages possibility space. But it's still a pretty big space, so we can still have a lot of creativity around there. But I thought it was an interesting point. Then, we're humans, that means that all those things that came so far were more the rational aspects of our language. So we can make a certain number of very rational decisions on what we want, what goals we want to attain, how we want to optimize things. But we also have a more irrational part, I guess, a more human part, and that part will be more pleased with something that feels aesthetically pleasing and beautiful. So one sense of satisfaction you can get when you program is the flow, I guess. How easy is it to get things out of your brain and onto the screen? How easy is it to do what you want, to make it do what you want? So when I started programming in Ruby 12 years ago, I was struck by this time library, which basically was pretty much natural language. So it was really easy to say, well, I want 2 days ago in the morning, perfect. So there was a sense of beauty, a sense of again getting things out of your brain into the paper. Whether that sense stands up to like making bigger, more abstract programming constructs is a question, obviously. Then there's another sort of alley for beautiful, which is elegant, aesthetically pleasing. The beauty we would find in a mathematical proof, for instance, or in something really, really clever. So you definitely find those in a lot of more functional programming languages sometimes. Like this is a fairly simple sort of box standards example that is given for Haskell, but you could transcribe that very easily to R lang or to others. Is quicksort. So you can see here, quicksort will sort your array. It will split it up in, it will take the first element, split it up in the things that are smaller, split up the things that are bigger than that element, and then range them beside each other, and iterate until it reaches something that is completely sorted. And this is expressed in three lines of code, and it's pretty clever when you think about it, and there's lots of examples like that. It's the kind of thing that is really nice to read, takes a while to understand, but takes like days to really write. But it's definitely pleasurable to have things like that. Then, does your language make us smarter? So again, like I read this this blog post not very long ago by Karen Meyer, and she describes the fact that like she referred to a story rather that happened in a school of Nicaragua. So in the school of Nicaragua, they gathered a lot of deaf people from all over the place who had never had education, but basically never interacted with other deaf people. And so they basically started, they observed something really interesting, is that they started to develop their own language amongst each other. So those were like individuals who are basically never really communicated with other deaf people and had been insulated in their worlds. And they started to develop their own human language amongst each other. And what was interesting is that they observed that after a few years, there was a much wider sort of language, a much more nuanced sort of language. So where people at the start couldn't really solve certain problems, like the younger generation started to be smarter. They started to be able to reason about those steps more. They started to have words for things, which allowed them to think about those things in a more sort of smarter way. And so Karen Meyer says, well, do we want that for our computer language as well? Does it have to give us concepts that will allow us to reason in a way that we weren't able to do before? And in her particular case, she was referring to Lisp macros, which allow you to really transform your program pretty strongly, or Clojure macros, rather, in that case. So macros do make us smarter in a way because they give us an alley of thought we didn't think about. But you know, you can also think of the actors of Erlang and the supervisor trees, or you can think of quantum computing, for instance. Will this sort of expand our mind into places that it wasn't able to go before? Will it give us a vocabulary that we didn't own before? Another possible alley for your language, does it make programming easier? So these are the logos of two private companies initiatives, Wolfram and Lee. So their aim is to make programming mainstream. So that means people who haven't studied programming, like your friends or your family, can suddenly decide to program something, or rather obtain information in a way that is sensible to them. So those two are trying to make programming, I guess, make us obsolete. This is the right word. So that would be also an interesting, it's definitely an interesting alley to watch. I'm slightly skeptical that it will allow something very complex, but you never know. Maybe I'm underestimating the creativity there. Then, I guess let's turn this program around, this talk around a little bit. So we've been talking about designing our own programming language. So this thought process can also go into how do we choose programming language. So if you were to pick a programming language and we're going down the decision tree with all the aspects we discussed before, what language would you get? So I think the things we've discussed so far are definitely arguments that will enter our decision. However, I think a lot of us go for this one as well. Smarter people than me have said I should use this language. And don't get me wrong, I think this is a perfectly acceptable train of thought. We live in a highly specialized society. We cannot know everything. We're not necessarily programming language experts. And so when smarter people than us tell us something is good, maybe it is, although maybe it isn't. It's certainly not wrong. I think where we want to watch this space is to look at more data-oriented approach. When people claim a language will make us faster, does it really make us faster? Does it make a program more maintainable? Those things should be measured. I think this is something we're missing at the moment. Then another pretty good reason, I think, is the community is a group I want to belong to. Like, okay, are they smart? Yes. Are they nice? Are they friendly? Are they welcoming? Do I want to hang out with them? Do I want to be in the hallway track in conferences and discuss things with them and have a drink with them after? I think those are perfectly valid reasons to sort of go and select the language. Also, in your choice of programming language, you could go for optimizations that have nothing to do at all with the language. Like, I know in my day, I knew people who did COBOL mainframes because that was a super lucrative. So if you want to make lots of money, you're probably going to do something that is used in the industry, but nobody else wants to do. So that's definitely something to consider when you choose. You can go for something you love. I think that's a good choice because something you love, you do 40 hours a week or more. It's definitely going to be important to something you enjoy, I think. But that may entail you quit your job and find another one, as I did at some point in my career. And not everyone can do that, obviously. If you have a family and things like that, it's not necessarily possible. And maybe the money approach is all right in that situation as well. And then you can go for what's out there. You can go for the cutting edge. You can go for research, for the next spaceship, for something that really interests you, gen technology or whatever. That's definitely something to optimize for as well. So anyway, I hope this presentation triggered you to think a little bit about what your ideal programming would look like. Is the programming you do in day-to-day, is it close to what your ideal programming would look like, programming language would look like? If not, do you want to change job or change your situation to do something that is closer to what your ideal programming language would look like? And if there is actually no programming language that looks like your ideal programming language, maybe you want to design a new one. I mean, there's space out there to do that. So I would say, go ahead. So that was my talk. Thank you for attending. Any questions?
Python was solved with solving header is included, so everyone might do, you can include it, or Perl, for example, is a huge library. So what do you think about this aspect of the programming language? How important do you think that?
Yeah, I think that's definitely a strong point. So the question was, what do you think about the importance of the existence of libraries for your language, like Perl or Python, which has a lot of libraries to talk with? I definitely think that plays a role in the choice when you're going to use a programming language. Like, you don't want to roll your own cryptography, that's like not a thing to do, or if you want to use advanced stats or maths, then Python or R or Octave or something, definitely the way to go. So that's true, that's going to limit your choices in some ways. Yeah. Yes?
So what makes the people that were your workplace sufficiently unhappy about the languages that they use to want to design new ones?
So I don't think, in that case, I don't think it was unhappiness, it was more intellectual curiosity. This is also a perfect.
You're implying that they are happy about the way we
use it. I think they are, yes. Yes, perfect, yeah.
So did you eventually design on a language, the ones you mentioned, or did you actually design your own?
So I think that's the next hackathon. We're going to spread this over several sessions. It's not quite there yet.
You mentioned that the influence of mathematical notation in programming language was something that catching up the last 5 or so years. What are examples for that?
I guess I was thinking of more functional composition kind of examples. And also category theory sort of things like they do in Haskell, using those concepts like definition of a monad or whatever, or all closer for me to mathematical concepts and everything else. Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to extend on this answer. I happen to know a guy who has the aim of designing a programming language that you can write like you write for mathematical formulae, for example. So you could write 2x instead of 2 times x. And so he's working on this for about 10 years, I think. And he has his own conference, not about this language, but each time he gives a talk about the state of his language. And it's very funny. I forgot the name of the
So what do you think are the main reasons why people and company don't evolve in this space, languages? So sometimes you just get stuck in main companies, or also some person, they just keep going with the same one, even though maybe they don't like it or it's not profitable. So there are many reasons, but yeah. What do you think are the main one you met?
Well, I think you all know slightly the reasons, having big legacy applications or having it's easier to write to hire a Java programmer potentially than it is a Haskell programmer.
It's false.
It's false?
No answer.
It's possible, yes.
Yeah. Also, because
there's this like common notion that like when you publish a job for Haskell, like people run to grab it.
That's true. Yes, for hiring it can be. I think to be honest, it's just it would be seen as a manager, you potentially don't see the point. You have something that works. So you don't see the point in investing money and time into trying anything else as long as it works. That is a pure capitalism sort of calculation in that respect. But it's true that it's short term and not necessarily a good calculation.
What do you personally prefer in languages? What are the languages you like?
I think definitely like Haskell, mostly because there's so much to discover. I don't feel like I've worked it all out yet. And well, I think Clojure is quite fun as well. And I definitely have had my eye on a few things like tag brackets and Lua and stuff. There's more things. Basically, I feel it like it's a moving target. I want to learn all the time.
So one aspect I'm slightly missing is I think you should also invest some time thinking about what the programming language you're designing is actually good for. I mean, if you're designing a specialized language which is small but solves that particular part pretty well, I think it's more valuable than if you start now, 2016, with a general purpose language,
yeah,
which is a major enterprise.
Yeah, it was actually one of the first slides is thinking about the purpose of your language. So I guess if you want to go for something like that, it's definitely a choice to make.
I realize this is probably a massively complex question, but maybe just if you would like to answer a couple of examples. But you've presented lots of different sort of options on many different dimensions and across the tree of all possible permutations that you could reach with any programming language would be massive. But there are surely trade-offs within those that prevent us from reaching a certain area. So, for example, if you're trying to achieve a systems programming language with a virtual machine, you're going to be limited in what you can do, so you can't really have, and you could have both at once, but you probably wouldn't want to. I wonder if I could invite you to highlight any particular trade-offs that perhaps that you thought about or that has occurred to you in mapping the language space like this.
I guess that would be a way to, I think for every choice there is trade-offs. Although the Go claims to be a systems language, and I think it does have a VM, so it's sort of hard to say. I guess, yes, if you really want to be... Yeah, there's always a trade-off, like, I guess the more on the compiled end of the spectrum you are, potentially maybe the faster you can go in some ways. Also, the closer to the metal you are, the faster you can go eventually, which is why game programming often uses C++, because they can really mess around at GPU level, for instance. I guess for every, like, dynamic typing versus static typing, there's whether you want everything type-checked at compilation time, and it makes you feel safer. There's always trade-offs, like, does it take more time to write something statically typed, but do you save time in maintenance? That's possible. There's always, I think sometimes we miss data on those things. Again, so a data specific approach and research could help in determining that. So it's a very wide question. I could basically go over the talk again and try and discuss the aspects and. I think most of you can probably imagine some of those as well.
Did you make me think about one aspect is the kind of tooling that the language would allow you to write? So. Like productivity boosters or maybe visualizations of your program that you could...
That is a very good point. Actually, you and this person over here had two very good points. Is when you choose a language or when you design a language, tooling will be super important, libraries will be super important. So those are definitely two aspects that I sort of didn't really go into in my talk.
One question. Do you think it's a good way to design always a new language? So we have maybe 2,000 or more languages currently, and it's more like an entropy, and everybody can make it in your own, but the complexity of choosing is quite yeah, different, more quite complex in the system.
There is definitely a paradox of choice kind of situation. On the other hand, it's Darwinist evolution, right? It's like, I think it's good to keep on investigating and keep on pushing things, and some will emerge and some will not. And for the unfortunate aspect is that the emergence of languages is not always rational, in the sense that it won't be the best language that wins, it's potentially the best publicized or the most important influential person, or you know, the best website or whatever. But I think it's good that that investigations continue.
I found that there are really plenty of resources to be found, you know, given a programming language. How do you like implement an interpreter or compiler for this? But what I haven't really found any resources on is, you know, given a domain, what is a sound process to design a programming language for this? I don't know if there's like really anything to be found that I've been looking for. But,
so I'm totally not an expert, but I would probably approach it as I would any other software problem, which is what do you want to achieve, design use cases, and go from there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.